All right, guys. Hi everyone. We are glad to welcome all of you to the second and final webinar on multi-regional API management. In this session, we will cover rate limiting and analytics related to multi-regional API management. I am Mushtaq Rumi, an associate technical lead at WSO2. Together with me, Samita Chaturanga, who is also an associate technical lead at WSO2, will conduct this webinar. Before starting the webinar, we have some announcements to give to you. First one is that you can post questions during the session, and we will answer them at the end of the webinar in the Q&A session. And we will share the slides and the recordings of the session to all the participants after the webinar within 24 hours. In this webinar, we will go through the multi-region or multi-data center API management deployment with regards to rate limiting and analytics. Here we have the agenda for today's webinar. At the beginning, we will do a recap on what we discussed in the last webinar session. Then we will focus on the points related to today's session by introducing API rate limiting and its importance. Next, we will take you through the concepts of global and local throttling. Then we will have a look at the concerns related to rate limiting as a whole when it comes to multi-regional or multi-data center API management deployment. We will finish the topic related to rate limiting by going through some multi-regional or multi-data center API management deployment patterns with rate limiting in place. Thereafter, we will be moving to analytics related to multi-regional API management by introducing analytics and its importance. Then we will elaborate concerns related to analytics as a whole when it comes to multi-regional API management deployment. Next, we will be going through some multi-regional API manager deployment patterns with analytics in place. And finally, we will do a demo with a real-world business use case, and we will move on to the question and answer session. Now let's do a recap on the last webinar session, which was on multi-regional API management deployment. We discussed challenges in on-premise API management deployments. Then we discussed what is multi-regional or multi-data center API management and why multi-regional and multi-DGC API management is important. Then we discussed general patterns of multi-regional deployments, followed with a demo with a real-world business use case. We also discussed concerns regarding rate limiting and analytics. These are the main points we covered in the last webinar session. Now let's move on to today's session by giving an introduction to rate limiting and its importance. First, let's look at what rate limiting is. Rate limiting is used to monitor incoming and outgoing traffic to or from a network. Let's assume, for example, that you are using the API of a particular service, which is configured to allow 100 requests per minute. If the number of requests you make goes beyond that point, an error will be triggered. Further, rate limiting policies can be at different levels, such as at application level, API level, resource level, and so on. Now, we will look at why an organization or a firm would need rate limiting. In order to protect your APIs from common types of security attacks, such as the certain types of denial of service attacks, which is commonly known as DDoS attacks, then this can be used to regulate traffic according to infrastructure availability and enforce a peak limit on backend services to prevent total outages. This can also be used to make an API, application, or a resource available to a consumer at different levels of service, usually for monetization purposes. Finally, this can be used to allow privileged rate limits based on location, device type, and user credentials. Now let's have a look at a business use case. Let's take an organization called ABC, which has an API to expose their mobile phone prices. This organization currently exposes prices to the sales agents, and they have a large number of third-party sales agents. They need to limit the total number of API calls to 50 requests per minute for this mobile price API. They need to limit the number of requests to 5,000 when specific third-party agent calls the mobile price API. They also need to allow API calls coming from a specific location, for example, from an IP address, and they need to restrict specific device types such as mobiles. Even though they allow a specific number of API calls for a given period of time, they need to limit the API calls that come at a given point in time to restrict the burst requests and to prevent their backend services. So this is a simple use case to explain why we need rate limiting. Now we will take a look at two types of rate limiting, which are global rate limiting and local rate limiting, and how those are achieved in WSO2 API Manager micro gateways. The first one we will be looking at is the local rate limiting. This means that having a node-specific rate limit in the distributed deployment or a cluster. We will take you through how this works in the WSO2 API Manager micro gateway, as shown in the picture. The WSO2 API micro gateway by default has an inbuilt mechanism to handle rate limiting. When a micro gateway project is initialized, an execution plan, which is related to the subscription level throttling policy defined in the API, is created in memory. The API micro gateway monitors the incoming requests and publishes the events to a stream defined in the inbuilt stream processing engine. This stream is then read and fed into the relevant predefined execution plan. The execution plan detects the throttling point and publishes an event to a stream called global throttle stream. When the global throttle stream is updated, the API micro gateway updates its local counters in background, as gateway is subscribed to the local throttle stream. So this is how the local rate limiting works in WSO2's API micro gateway. So when it comes to global rate limiting, it means that there will be a single rate limit throughout the distributed deployment. So as we discussed previously, WSO2 API micro gateway has an in-memory mechanism by default to handle throttling. In a distributed micro gateway deployment, throttling becomes a challenge with the current implementation. This is because throttling decisions are taken by evaluating the local counter maintained within each node. Hence, scaling the micro gateway will multiply the allowed limits. For example, if the throttling limit is set to 10, and if we have three gateways in a cluster, it will allow 30 requests to pass to the backend before all three gateways throttle out requests. So this will put an unexpected load on the backend. In order to address this, the API micro gateway supports distributed throttling, where it is able to work with a central traffic management solution. The API micro gateway, upon receiving a request, checks against the local counter, and if throttling limit has not exceeded it, and publishes the events via a stream to a central traffic management solution. This is done over HTTP. The central traffic management solution then executes throttle policies against the event stream. When a particular request is throttled, the central traffic management solution sends the details of the throttled out event to a JMS topic. Each API micro gateway node is subscribed to this JMS topic and updates the local counter when this particular JMS topic is updated. Therefore, the API micro gateway nodes gets notified of the throttle decisions through JMS messages. So this was an in-depth introduction on how global rate limiting works. All right, now that we have discussed some basic information about rate limiting, let's take a look at some problems or concerns related to rate limiting with regards to multi-regional deployment. The first issue that an organization might face when it comes to multi-regional deployment, having rate limiting in place, is that throttling decisions might be inaccurate. This issue might happen when global rate limiting in place. If we take a look at the diagram shown in the slide, there is a two-region deployment with two micro gateways in each region, while there is only a single central traffic manager in just one region, which is the region one. As shown in the diagram, the micro gateways in region two will retrieve the throttling decisions from the traffic manager placed in region one. Due to this, there might be latency issues when updating the traffic manager with the count and getting the throttling decisions to the micro gateway. Let's assume that the global throttling limit is 100 requests per second throughout the two regions, and there are requests coming to region two. Due to the latency issues, the requests coming to region two might only be throttled out after around 120 requests per second. This might have severe impacts on businesses while using monetization policies. Now let's take a look at the second concern of having rate limiting in multi-regional deployments. The second concern will be the bandwidth utilization across all the regions in a multi-regional API management deployment. This concern will also be in place when the global rate limiting is in place. For example, if we take a look at the diagram shown in the slide, there are three regions with only one traffic manager to handle the rate limiting. In this case, there will be data published to the traffic manager from other regions. When there is a higher load, an organization might have to have a higher bandwidth to cater the requirement. This also can bring some additional cost into it. Now let's take a look at the two multi-regional API management deployments with traffic manager in place. With these deployment patterns, some of the issues discussed before will be addressed. In these patterns, we have excluded the other components of the API manager, as we have discussed this in the previous webinar. All right, so the pattern one is a single traffic manager in each region. This will have a single traffic manager in each of the regions, along with two micro gateways in each region. As you can see in the diagram, the throttling policies in the two traffic manager servers will be synchronized using rsync, and the micro gateway will publish data to those traffic managers. The latency concern will be solved somewhat in this scenario. In case, if an organization wants to have region-specific throttling, that can be achieved by pointing the micro gateways in each region to the respective traffic managers in each region. This will make sure that the rate limiting is applied accurately for each region. Now, let's move on to the second pattern. So the pattern two is traffic managers with HA or active in each region. The second pattern will have two, that is HA or active traffic managers in each of the region, along with two micro gateways in each region. As you can see in the diagram, the throttling policies in the two traffic manager servers within the region will be shared using NFS, while the NFS between the two regions will be synchronized using rsync, and the micro gateways will publish data to those traffic managers. An organization can make slight modification to this pattern and make the rate limiting happen in a region-specific manner, as we discussed in the previous pattern. Next, we will move on to the analytics section with regards to the multi-regional deployments. And Samita will take over from here. So over to you, Samita.
Thank you, Mustaq. I will start this section with a brief introduction to analytics and its importance in API management solutions. Businesses consistently produce large amounts of information in various forms, such as financial transactions, sensor measurements, stock trades, interactions with mobile services, system logs, and so on. So this is same to API-driven enterprise applications and related businesses too. Digital enterprises depend on streaming analytics and real-time data processing to gain the competitive edge in day-to-day business operations. API management has the potential to enable the wider use of analytics due to two factors. First is the extensive adoption of API management solutions to expose business activities as APIs. This has been growing at more than 35% per year since 2016. Second is the strategic positioning of API management within all of the message flows of an organization. APIs are becoming the doorways through which all internal and external interactions of API of an enterprise flow. As APIs become the mediators of all interactions, the API management solution can become a portal that shows how an organization works. So WSO2 API Manager is facilitated with the product WSO2 API Manager Analytics to cater this requirement. It provides reports, statistics, and graphs on the APIs deployed in WSO2 API Manager and provide alerts to monitor these APIs and detect unusual activity, manage locations via geolocation statistics, and carry out detailed analysis of the logs. In this diagram, you can see how analytics solution is layered on top of API management. WSO2 API Manager Analytics Server provides insights for detailed analysis of revenue and cost contribution. And it also enables to analyze trends and forecasting of incoming and outgoing money flows based on trends and historical data. It enables customer journey analysis that explores how the sales pipeline converts to customers. It also supports fraud detection based on overall activities as well as individual customers when they deviate from normal behavior. Now let's discuss about the concerns and important factors when dealing with analytics in a multi-regional API management deployment. First concern is about the bandwidth consumption when publishing data across regions or multiple DCs. When we have separate micro gateways in multiple regions to receive API traffic, the most simple and generic approach to achieve a global analytics solution is to have a central analytics server in either of the regions. So the API invocation stacks will be published to the central analytics server, and it can aggregate and process data coming from all the regions to generate statistics. But the problem here is that even a micro gateway residing in a very distant region has to publish analytics events to the analytics server. This will be a cross-regional data communication on the network, and there will be higher latency in this communication. So it will require high bandwidth for analytics to work smoothly. But what is the solution for this problem? We will discuss on that in a few minutes. Other than the bandwidth concern, there is this other major problem in a central analytics server. As you can see in this diagram, all the analytics events from all the regions will be published to the central analytics server. So you have a very high traffic to deal with in the analytics server. Analytics server will need higher processing power to process all these simultaneous analytics events. This is not an ideal approach since the high traffic can cause many issues in production systems if appropriate actions are not taken. Okay, so now we know the challenges we have to face with analytics in a multi-regional deployment. Let's look about what we can do about this. The solutions for above described problems can be addressed via the specific patterns that we can deploy WS2 API Manager analytics. I will describe two such patterns. The pattern one is having one analytics server per each region. There will also be an analytics database within each region to store analytics data. The stats data will be published from micro gateway nodes to the analytics server, which is lying in the old region. This will reduce the high bandwidth requirement to publish data across regions as we discussed previously. And also now there are two analytics servers to handle traffic in a sharing basis if considered the whole deployment. Each analytics server will consume half of the traffic as opposed to the simple deployment of single central analytics server. So this approach reduces the high traffic problem. Data stored in the two analytics databases needs to be replicated from one to the other, so that the same data will be maintained in both the regional analytics databases. So this will ensure a global analytics viewpoint. Analytics aggregation data will be written into the DB with the shared ID, chart ID, which is a unique ID to the analytics server node, so that there won't be data duplication issues while DB data replication. This pattern is almost similar to the previous pattern, except for having two analytics servers per each region. This will ensure high availability of analytics servers within each region. Micro gateways will publish analytics data to the analytics server through a load balancer. So it is possible to configure failover or load balanced approach to publish data to analytics servers. Okay, so that is it about the theoretical aspects of analytics and throttling concerns in multi-regional API management deployments. Now we will do a short demo to emphasize these concepts in a real world use case and a deployment. So this demo has a deployment with two regions. They are APAC region and US region. And this is a deployment of a financial institution called ABC Bank. And we are talking about two APIs deployed in micro gateways. One is the exchange rates API, which exposes some services related to exchange rates. Other one is the loan details API, which exposes some services related to loans. Loan details API needs to be deployed only in US region, since loan facility is provided for customers in US region only. But exchange rates API is deployed in both the regions, since exchange details info is expected to expose to customers in all the regions. Okay, so before going to the demonstration, I will illustrate the deployment architecture of this multi-regional setup. Each region has two micro gateway nodes and they are fronted by a load balancer. So API invocation traffic coming to ABC band rv1nv.apm.com URL will be routed to the APAC region, and traffic coming to the ABC band rv2nv2.apm.com will be routed to US region. Both the regions have separate analytics server node and a traffic manager node, which are connected to the two micro gateways in own region. In APAC region, analytics node starts both worker and dashboard profiles. But in the US region, only worker profile is started. And two all-in-one API manager nodes are there in the APAC region, by which all the API publishing, subscribing, and lifecycle management is done. An API manager related database is existing in the APAC region only. And two separated analytics databases are in both regions. They are configured to have two-way data replication. Okay, so now we are going to start our demonstration. Okay, now I have logged in. I am going to log into the admin portal of WS2 API Manager. So I am going to show you how we can add micro gateway labels via this admin dashboard. So to add the micro gateway label, we have to give the label name. So actually this micro gateway label represents micro gateway environment. So we'll provide the suitable name for this. And we have to provide some description here. And then we have to provide the host name or the host via this micro gateway environment will reside. Likewise, this we can we give the host name, and we have to provide give save to add this micro gateway label. And you can see that I have already added two micro gateway labels. They are APAC region and US region. So the APAC region is having this host name, and US region is having this this host name. So we will be using these two micro gateway labels for our APIs. And other than that, I want to show you how we can create subscription policies in our API manager environment. To create a subscription policy, we click here and provide some suitable name like this. And here we can provide the request count and unit time. That means the throttling, the API invocation will allow only for 10 API requests per minute. And there are these other additional attributes you can provide. So for now, for this simple setup, we are giving only these things. And we have to provide save to save this throttling policy. Anyway, we have already added this test testing subscription policy called test subs policy, and it has a quota of 10 requests per minute. So keep in mind we'll be using this subscription policy for our APIs. And now we are going to the API publisher portal. So you can see these two APIs are already been created and published also. So let's go to one of these Exchange Rates API, and let's see the resources of this API. So this slash rates get resource API is here. So by invoking this resource, you can get the rates, exchange rates, and there is also this other resource also. And now let's see the subscriptions. We can give to subscription policies we can assign to this API. So I have ticked already this test subscription policy I created earlier. Okay, so then let's see the environments. That means which micro gateway labels we have assigned to this region, to this API. So I have assigned both the regions for this API. So effect region label and use region labels are assigned to this API. So that means this this API will be deployed in both these regions and actually the in the micro gateways within these regions. Okay, so now it is how it is there. And this is the loan details API. Let's see the resources of this API. We have this get loan resource, which we can call to get the loan details. And let's go to see the subscription plans. So I have already subscribed to this test subs policy for this API. Then let's see which micro gateway labels are assigned to this API. So since this API is exposed to the region use region only, I have in ticked to this use region label only. Okay, so this is how we have the two APIs in this publisher portal. Okay, so now we are going to the developer portal. So you can see these two APIs in the dev portal because both the APIs are published here. Now let's see the subscription. You can see the available micro gateway labels here because we had assigned these labels to the API. And here the subscriptions, we can actually create a preferred application here. Let's say I am going to create a new application here, like this, and we can give provide the suitable per token quota and select the token type and additional description and save. So likewise the application is saved and we can go back to the APIs and let's try to see whether this application is available to subscribe like this. We can, and also we can subscribe provide the subscription policy we had given to this API, and we can likewise subscribe to this API. And as here you can see we have this subscription we have this already we have our these applications already been subscribed to this API with this subscription policy, this test subs policy. And to invoke this API, what we have to do is generate a token. So here you can give select the appropriate grant types. So we'll directly go to generate the access token here. You can provide the preferred access token validity period and click on generate. So here you can see the access token is generated. So be so don't forget to copy this token because once we close this window, it will be gone forever. So you can't see it from anywhere else. Okay, so now we have copied the access token, and what we are left to do is to invoke the APIs from this token. Okay, so now we will go to the steps that we need to create required micro gateway executables so that we can use them to start micro gateway instances. Okay, for this to create a micro gateway project, we have to install micro gateway toolkit in your machine. So I have already installed micro gateway toolkit in my machine, and I have provided the path to micro gateway bin folder, so I can invoke, I can call the MicroGateway commands directly from this folder. So as I said earlier, I am going to create a MicroGateway related project here. So I already copied the command requests. Okay. So this is the MicroGateway init command that actually creates a MicroGateway project as you want. So I have given this name for this project and press enter. Okay, so as this, we have created and initialized this APAC project. Now what we have to do is we have to import particular MicroGateway labels, and actually what happens is it imports the particular APIs assigned with that label into this MicroGateway project. So for that, we have to give this import command. Here I have given the import command with the APAC region label, and you have to give the project name we had created, and here you have to provide the admin user password, and you have to provide the API manager base URL. So actually I had used this environment earlier, so it automatically suggests this API base URL. So I put enter for that. Okay, so that's it. So it builds the API manager, so it imports the related APIs with regards to that label we provided. So so what we have to do now is we have to build the APAC project so that we can create an executable jar file which we can use to start MicroGateway instances. Okay, so we are going to give that build command. So just MicroGateway build with the project name. So it is started building the project, and this will take some time. And meanwhile, I'll show you we have to create another MicroGateway project to represent that other region also. So that is our US region. So we can provide this init command for US project, and then import that related MicroGateway label and related APIs to this project, and then build the US project. So let's see how it is being created. Okay, yeah. So the executable jar file is created in the target folder in this APAC project created folder. So now what we have to do is we have to copy this MicroGateway executable jar file into our particular instance we have to start MicroGateways. Okay, so this environment I'm going to start the MicroGateway instance. So I have already downloaded the MicroGateway runtime distribution here. You have to start the MicroGateway like this. So you have to provide the gateway. You have to run the gateway script with start command, and you have to provide the path for the MicroGateway executable jar file. So I am actually now in this in the instance in US region. So I am starting the particular MicroGateway instance with this US project jar. Let's see what happens. And let's try to see the log files. Okay, so it has started this instance like this. So in this similar way, we have to start all other MicroGateway instances in our particular regions and particular servers. So actually I have already started all those servers. So in this left hand side, you can see this APAC region related two instances. We call it MG1, MG2. And in the right hand side, you can see the server instances related to US region. So this is MG3 and MG4. Now, what we have to do is we can invoke this APIs and see what happens. I have already copied the API invocation URLs with the copied access tokens. So this here I am going to invoke Exchange Rates API, and the invocation goes to the region one, that means the APAC region. So let's see what happens. Yeah. So we see this API invocation received message because I have provided the interceptor to log the message. This API invocation received message. So we can say that the invocation came to this instance. Likewise, we will invoke the other region also. So that means the region 2, yeah, like that. This the invocation reached this micro gateway. This is the US region, and now let's invoke the other API. That means the get loan API, loan details API. So we will be invoking the get loan resource, and you know that we have deployed this API only in the US region. So we will be invoking it with making the invocation to the US region only, this region. Okay, so you can see this response. This is some loan details, duration, rates, and something like that. And the invocation reached this US region. You can see by this log message. And other than that, you can try invoking this API in the APAC region. So we know that we have not deployed this API in the micro gateway node in APAC region. So what we see, let's see what happens. Yeah. So it gives this no matching service bound response. So as expected, it is not working like this because it is not being deployed into that region. And now we are clear about how these instances are working. Like when we have published the APIs in particular micro gateway environments only. So now let's see throttling, how we can use throttling and how it happens. So I am going to invoke this get loan resource of the loan details API. So we have actually subscribed to a throttling policy which allows only 10 requests per minute. So ideally it should be throttled out after 10 requests. So let's see whether it will happen. I'm making 11 requests. Okay, so you can see this message, throttled out message. So that means we have exceeded the quota. So throttling has worked like this. And now let's see about the analytics. Let's go to the analytics dashboard of WS2 API Manager Analytics Server. So you can see these three portals, three dashboards. So let's go to the API publisher dashboard. Yeah, so here you can see multiple information about multiple statistical information about API invocations, total out summary. Here you can see the number is 19 because I have already tried this before, and there are 19 totaled out scenarios, and the API usage summary, there are 2, 3, 6 API invocations, and also we can go to the API developer portal dashboard. Here you can see how API usage for applications, and what is the count of each API here. Likewise, and that other important thing is that we see this statistical data as an aggregation of both regions. That means that this analytics show statistic details about the both regions. So the global analytics view is being displayed here, as we have configured it like that. Okay, so that is it about the demonstration, and that's all we have for this second and final webinar of the multi-region API management webinar series. Now we are happy to take some questions from you.
So you can post your questions in the questions panel on the GoToMeeting control panel.
Okay.
So seems like we don't have any more questions. So we will move on.
Okay. So there are some important links which will be useful to you. So we invite you to download and try out WS2 API management solutions from this link. And we also have a Slack channel, ws2-apm.slack.com. You can ask any question about WS2 API manager and related deployments and questions on this Slack channel. And we have these two major GitHub repositories which are related to WS2 API manager, and also the demonstration materials about we used in this webinar are already been uploaded to this GitHub location. So you can try out the same demonstration what we did today with your own using these artifacts. And thank you. That is it. Thank you everyone for joining this webinar. By the way, you will get a small 30-second survey at the end of this webinar. So please feel free to fill it and share your thoughts.
So thank you very much, everyone, for joining. So we can end this webinar. So hope everyone will keep safe. And goodbye.